First, I just want to say thank you for everybody for coming today and for the MSPCC for putting this series together to help educate the legislators about the important about this important topic. And I want to thank Dr. Forkey for coming to speak today. As many of us in this meeting already know, a better understanding of childhood trauma is essential to helping support children across the Commonwealth. And trauma affects children in all aspects of life and can have huge impacts on kids and the rest of their lives. We as legislators have a lot of work to do with respect to our approach to childhood trauma. There isn't a statewide definition of childhood trauma currently, and we don't have a central place for folks working with children to go to get support in responding to trauma. That said, there's important, impressive work already being done on this topic in Massachusetts. Some of those highlights include, number one, a program focused on childhood trauma and a pilot program relating to educator training on trauma-informed responses coming out of the UMass Medical School, where many distinguished speakers will hear from in this series work. The Childhood Trauma Task Force, which is studying our current approach to childhood trauma and making recommendations for future changes. And the legislature actually created this task force back in 18. Three, a number of bills in front of the Joint Committee on Children, Families, and Persons with Disabilities that would make exciting advances in the field of childhood trauma. Just to name one, we recently heard H238/S81, which would create a center for child wellness and trauma. And the center would serve as a statewide hub for trainings and organizational support for children serving organizations and help streamline the approach to childhood trauma in Mass. I'm excited to keep working on these issues and to learn more about childhood trauma through this series. I know that we have 5 sessions throughout the fall on different topics, and I'm looking forward to all that. And so I just want to say thank you, Mary, for allowing me to have the ability to be a part of this series.
Thank you. Thank you. Senator Gomez, would you like to say a few words?
Thank you so much. Thank you, Chair Finn, for your remarks. Hello, all. I'm Senator Adam Gomez from Springfield, and I also serve as the Senate Chair of the Joint Committee on Children, Families, and Persons with Disability. This is my first legislative session serving as Senator of the Hampton District, and I was named Senate Chair of the committee shortly after being sworn in back in January of 2021. As I'm sure many of you know, child welfare and advocacy are far from an easy task. And following my appointment to the committee, we were alerted of the death of David Allman and the need for an oversight hearing. Through that hearing and subsequent meetings, I have received a crash course on issues children and families in our state are facing and have had the opportunity to hear from a wide variety of advocates, stakeholders, and fellow legislators, executive branch members, and experts like the Massachusetts Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Children. Understanding the impact of trauma on the developing brain is paramount to learning how we can prevent negative outcomes for the most vulnerable young people in our Commonwealth. While I am learning more every day about the complex nature of child advocacy and welfare to the state, there is also more to learn, something that I hope we can all do today and as this series continues. Thank you to the MSPCCC, my House Chair Finn, and all the staff who work diligently and hard to pull this all together. Thank you, and let's enjoy the information that is before us.
Well, great, thank you. And again, thank you very much, Chair Gomez and Chair Finn, as well as the other members of the legislature and your teams who are joining us today. We really appreciate your taking the time. I know how busy you all are. But I promise you, it will be an engaging and thoughtful presentation. As I said, my name is Mary McKeown, and I'm the Executive Director of MSPCC. I'm also part of a collaboration that, with generous support from the Health Foundation of Central Massachusetts, has kicked off Encompass. Really, it's pretty simple because it's based on the philosophy that a well-trained and properly supported foster and kinship parents are critical to a high-quality, child-centered foster care system that effectively mitigates the impact of trauma. So foster parents are really play an important role in our child welfare system. And our project is all about helping them be well-trained and properly supported. I don't do this work a lot, and our next slide will give you a sense of really the unbelievable group of people that I've been able to work with as part of this collaboration. They each bring something really important to the table, and I couldn't do this work without them. But to be honest with you, today and our future sessions is not really exactly about the Encompass Project. We want to take a few steps back and focus on what we know about adverse childhood experiences, toxic stress, and trauma, and the impact on brain development. Because it is all about science and understanding the tools that help a child recover and heal. Child development research tells us that children need consistency, predictability, and attachment to a caring adult to thrive. And this is especially true for children in foster care who have experienced trauma leading up to and including removal from their home. Our goals during today and future sessions are to provide an understanding of trauma and its effects, to understand a child's behaviors as symptoms of trauma, and to learn the best responses to children who have experienced trauma. Leading our presentation today is Dr. Heather Forkey. Dr. Forkey is a professor of pediatrics, chief of the Division of Child Protection, and director of the Child Protection Program and Foster Children Evaluation Services at UMass Memorial's Children's Medical Center. She is an expert on the impact of child abuse and trauma and works across systems to raise awareness of the impact of trauma and to promote healing through evidence-based approaches. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Forkey. Dr. Forkey?
Thank you so much, Mary. I am so delighted to be working with you guys today. Certainly, you've heard that the kids that we care for here at UMass have often experienced a variety of adversities, but so many of the kids in the Commonwealth, that's true for whether we see them or not. And some of those adversities are in fact quite severe, like the kids that we care for. Many kids have been exposed to physical abuse, witnessing maternal and paternal substance misuse, witnessing domestic violence, having significant issues related to homelessness and poverty. But even when kids haven't had sort of these severe exposures, many, many kids are exposed to, I don't even know that I'd use the term routine, but sort of traumas that are persistent and indolent. Issues of poverty, issues of strife in a household that, boy, I don't know that we would call it domestic violence, but it's just not a nice place to be. In fact, we don't always know what a child has experienced. And I have to tell you that now, in the work that I do, the kids who come to see me, you wouldn't be brought to see us in our programs unless you've had a number of adversities. But that wasn't always true for me. And in fact, I was recently reminded of an experience I had had when I was working as a resident in the emergency department. I had been working overnights in the emergency department, and I worked in a children's hospital in Philadelphia, and it was right next to an adult hospital. And so most of the time when kids are involved with juvenile justice or the law, they went to the adult hospital, no matter what age they were. But for whatever reason, this night, a young man was brought to see us in shackles, and he had been in a fight in school that day, and he had been arrested because the fight had been so severe. And it wasn't until they were processing him at the police department that they realized that the tooth of the person he had been fighting had gotten embedded in his hand. And I have to tell you that that whole event sort of stuck in my mind for a number of reasons, but I had largely forgotten about it until I was listening to an NPR program, a National Public Radio program called This American Life. And in this particular episode, they were looking at the exposures kids have to violence. They had first created this program not long after the Sandy Hook shootings in Connecticut, which, while horrendous, was the experience of violence in a school on one particular day. But what they were making a point during this program was that so many of our kids have experienced violence and adversities every day or most days of their lives. And in this particular section, the reporter Alex Kotlowitz was doing the reporting. Now, you may have heard of him. He's written There Are No Children Here. He's done a lot of reports about kids in Chicago. And he was interviewing a young man named Thomas. And he was interviewing Thomas with his school, what would be the equivalent of an adjustment counselor in the school. And Thomas had experienced many, many adversities. He was in foster care living with his grandparent because one of his parents had died of substance misuse and an overdose, and another parent was incarcerated. He had also been witness to a lot of community violence. He had been present at a birthday party when he was a little kid for a girl named Nugget, and there was a drive-by shooting. And as the kids were ushered out of the birthday party, he saw Nugget's brain material on the ground. He also had been present when his brother had been shot and paralyzed, and he had witnessed other members of his community being victimized by gun violence. But the reason they were interviewing Thomas at this particular point in time is that he had been standing with a girl named Shikaki when Shikaki had been shot. And now Shikaki was the school's bright light. She was a basketball star. She had gotten a full scholarship to college. She was getting out of this neighborhood. And she had subsequently, after being shot, died of her injuries. And I'm going to actually just play some of the audio for you, because their description of what happened for Thomas is far better than what I could do. So let me just play that.
The shooter, dressed in a gray hoodie, came running up alongside the building. Thomas pleaded with him not to shoot. But the shooter fired several rounds, hitting Shikaki three times and Thomas's brother once in the thigh. Thomas ran, but quickly came back. He says that when Shikaki was laying on the ground, he first thought she'd be okay.
Because when she got shot, then they like, she gonna be all right then. Because when she was on the ground, she was talking, but all she kept saying it burned.
She was saying that it burned. When the ambulances finally showed up, they took Shikaki and Thomas's brother to the hospital, leaving Thomas alone. He didn't go home. He was just alone.
Yeah. They took her. Then I took my brother. Then I walked off mad. I walked to the gas station to see who I could see.
At the gas station, he didn't find anyone.
Ever since that day, I was just trying to hurt everybody. I sleep the whole week. She got shot on Saturday. She died Sunday. I was sleepless for a whole week.
He was filled with grief, anxiety, guilt, and then he got into a fight.
And what'd you get into a fight over?
Nothing important.
Thomas says an older kid on the street pushed his little cousin to the ground. Thomas was furious. He went after the older boy.
It wasn't no fight. It was just, I just hit him. He walked off crying. All that. I didn't know his teeth was in my hand until I looked at it.
Thomas punched the boy so hard, one of the boy's teeth got stuck in Thomas's hand. Later that night, his grandma took him to the hospital, and he eventually had surgery on his hand. He told me that once he hurt his hand, he was able to sleep again. It was that simple. Getting into this stupid fight, it brought him relief.
And I have to tell you that when I heard that report, I suddenly remembered the case that I'd had in the emergency room all those years ago. And I also realized that not for one second of the whole time I was taking care of that young man all night long, had I thought at all about what had happened before he came to see me and before that fight. And yet all of those things that kids experience, those are the things that actually matter most. So that when kids come to school and to the doctor and to daycare, we need to be appreciating all of those things that have happened. So I'm going to talk to you briefly about the Adverse Childhood Experiences Study, which began to help us understand what we were seeing. We're going to talk about what trauma looks like in kids. We're going to do a little bit of science around the developing brain. We're going to talk about which kids exposed to these stressors present with symptoms and how we can identify them and respond. You know, the Adverse Childhood Experiences Study is probably something you guys by now have all heard of. This is the first study, it came out in 1998, and it linked childhood experience and adult outcome. And although many people have heard of the study, many people don't actually haven't heard the story of how it came to be. And I actually think that that's fairly interesting and important to know. So the study was done by a researcher named Anda and Folletti. And now Folletti was a preventive medicine doc. And he was, at this particular point in time, the early 90s, he was running an obesity clinic for adults. And what he found was that the adults that would enroll in his program, they would even start to lose weight and then they would drop out. And he became really frustrated. Like, why did they keep dropping out? So he decided that he was going to start to interview his patients and kind of get some understanding of kind of health choices and what their life of healthcare had been like. So he was asking a series of questions to a woman, sort of asking her, how much did you weigh when you were born? How much did you weigh as an adult? And then he accidentally said to her, how much did you weigh when you were first sexually active? Which was actually a mistaken question. And yet she quickly answered it and said, I was 40 pounds. And he's like, what, wait? And then she said, yeah, my dad raped me when I was 4. And you know, he didn't just throw that information out. He said, okay. And he took that and he decided that he was going to thoughtfully incorporate that question as he asked other people these same set of questions. And what he found was that many people were reporting that they had experienced many bad things in their childhood. And so he thought, well, maybe it's me. Maybe I'm introducing some kind of bias. So he asked his colleagues to ask the same questions. And so they did, and they got the same answers. So they took this information to the obesity meetings, the medical meetings about obesity that year. They presented the data and they got laughed out of the meeting. They got told that's not true, people lie, that's not a thing. Okay, so he comes back from the study and he pairs up with a researcher named Anda. Now Anda works at the CDC at this point in time, and Anda is probably the first person who was starting to look at childhood exposure and adult outcome, mainly around environmental exposure, like things that could cause cancer later in life, recognizing that those exposures can happen in childhood. But what they're gonna do is they decide they're gonna look at what about these types of exposures, these bad things that can happen to kids. And so they create a study with a questionnaire. And it's a questionnaire that asks adults about some bad things that they have experienced in childhood. And they find a population that they can administer this questionnaire to in the people who have Kaiser Permanente health insurance in California. Now, reminder, this is the mid 90s. And so they're giving this questionnaire, ultimately, they give this questionnaire to 17,000 adults who have Kaiser Permanente health insurance in California. And this questionnaire asks questions about ultimately sort of 10 categories of things that can happen to kids. So mostly about abuse, 6 types of abuse, emotional abuse, physical abuse, sexual abuse. It also asks about household dysfunction, including parental substance misuse, parental incarceration, parental divorce, and domestic violence in the household. And so everybody who answers this questionnaire can get a score, a maximum score of 10 of the possible bad things that they experienced in childhood. It's given to a group of people who, by all of our looking at it now, 20 some years later, would say is a really uniform population and probably not the best one to study, because these are, with Kaiser Permanente health insurance, they're all Californians, they're mostly middle-aged, they're mostly white, they're employed, and middle income. But what they found, just by giving out that questionnaire, was very intriguing. What they found was that only a third of people had not had a bad thing happen to them, and 1 in 8 had had 4 or more bad things happen to them. We didn't realize that at that time, that these exposures in childhood were all that common. This was the first study that showed in such a profound way that that was true. And I'll tell you that this study now has been replicated hundreds of times, and that these relationships are probably as good as it gets. If you ask in any population, usually you find that more people have not had bad thing, or fewer people have not had bad things happen to them, and more people have had 4 or more bad things happen to them. But they didn't stop there, and they began to look at sort of the health data that they had on these adults from the Kaiser Permanente records. And what they found was that in a dose response way, meaning the more ACEs someone identified, the more likely they were to have mental health consequences in adulthood. And so you may say to yourself, well, that's not such a shocker, right? I mean, if you have bad things happen to you, it's going to impact your mental health, right? So that's kind of a duh study. But they also linked it with physical health. And what they found was the same dose response. The more adversity someone experienced in childhood, the more likely they are to have bad health outcomes in adulthood. Things like ischemic heart disease, stroke, COPD, diabetes, sexually transmitted disease. And I will point out to you that the associations are pretty profound. Like that association with ischemic heart disease, it looks kind of low. It looks like maybe it's the lowest in the grouping. But your risk of ischemic heart disease from four or more ACEs is higher than your risk of ischemic heart disease from having both diabetes and high cholesterol. And yet we in medicine ignored this study. I mean, I would suggest to you as adults, you've probably gone to your physician, they've tested you for diabetes and they've checked your cholesterol level, but has anyone asked you what you experienced in childhood? It also has profound implications for us as a Commonwealth and as a nation. The higher ACE score a person has, the more likely they are to have outcomes like absenteeism, financial problems, job problems. Those are the things that impact us at a societal level. So it wasn't just us in medicine that were ignoring this at our peril, but we as a nation ignored this at our peril. And I can probably only explain why we ignored it from medicine, because we in medicine didn't understand how these bad things could happen and you could have these bad outcomes, but what the middle part was. There was obviously something related to health risk behaviors, right? So if your dad smoked, you're more likely to smoke. And so making health choices may have been influenced by your experience growing up. But we could statistically wipe out those health risk behaviors and we would still find these associations the same in the same order. And it wasn't until these past 20 years that we've begun to understand the neurobiologic and psychosocial effects that these adversities have, and that is why these adversities in childhood are having these long-term consequences for adults. And so that's what I'm going to talk to you about. But the first step for us is to recognize what are we looking for? Because I have to tell you, when I trained, I was told, look for this if you're looking for trauma. Look for young adult males who were returning from wartime. But trauma in kids doesn't look the same way as it does in young adult males returning from wartime trauma. Kids are not little adults. And so we don't see the same symptoms. We see the little girl with a vacant look in her eye. We see the little boy who's gotten kicked out of preschool and kindergarten. And we see the young adults who are getting in trouble with the law and showing up in my emergency room. And why, I guess you have to ask the question, why do kids look differently than adults? And some of it has to do with the fact that their exposures are different, right? So while some kids we know are exposed to war and terrorism and coming to the US, more commonly what we're seeing is emotional abuse, loss, impaired caregivers, domestic violence, sexual abuse, neglect, physical abuse. But it's not just the exposure. It also has to do with what is happening in childhood. And this goes back to the developing brain. You know, when I was in medical school in embryology class, I had this professor and he said, you know, the human baby is only born within 9 months because the human baby has to get through the female pelvis, and in 9 months is the maximum size of a head to get through a female pelvis. And in fact, the baby's brain is not ready to be born. And that is entirely true. Like as someone who's now delivered children, I completely agree in a way I couldn't have appreciated when I was going through medical school. But the other fact is that we know the human babies are different than any other species, right? You watch the Nature Channel, the giraffe gets born, falls from the mother, snapping the umbilical cord, interesting fact. And the giraffe gets up on his little legs and walks over to mom and says, where are we gonna go for lunch today? Human babies aren't even close to that ready. We have to do huge amounts of brain development. That brain is still developing millions of connections each second. Those neurons are growing, making more neurons in a process called neurogenesis. They're moving to the place in the brain where they belong. We're branching out or arborizing, making so that those neurons can reach out and touch other neurons and make connections called synapses in a process called synaptogenesis. Eventually, we prune away what we don't need and we put a sheath over the whole thing so it runs very quickly. And so what you see is in these first years of life, this massive, massive amount of neuron development and connection. And we've had to rewrite the textbooks because we had no idea how quickly and how intensely this is happening in the first years of life. I will point out to you that as you sit here listening to me, you're just decaying. But for children, it's happening so, so rapidly. But what is guiding that development actually is environment, right? So unfortunately, if a child is left in a car seat and not attended to or put in a pack and play and no one picks up that child, even if they get to the age when they're supposed to be able to walk, they won't be able to walk. They're brought to us in the child protection program that with those problems all the time. You have to pick the baby up. You have to hold their hands. You have to let them practice. When they fall down, you have to say, come on, let's try it again. If we want a child to learn language or learn how to talk, we have to talk back and forth with that child, a process called serve and return, back and forth, back and forth. First they coo, and then they make a noise and we give it meaning. And then we pretend that we understand what they're saying, and back and forth. And slowly kids become aware of language and how to use language. Those language skills then become words that become the basis of reading skills. Serve and return, back and forth, minute by minute, day after day. But if that is true for these good things, it's also true for the bad things. And the brain is adapting and changing so that children can survive and thrive as best they can in whatever environment that they're in. In pediatrics, we've come to understand this in the context of the spectrum of stress, right? The idea is that no life is without stress, right? Most stress that kids experience is what we would call positive stress. These are normal and essential pieces of growing. It causes some brief discomfort, but it allows you to grow and to meet a challenge. It's like the final exam or the playoff game. Things that challenge a child, they rise to the occasion, and now they grow and learn. There are many things that kids experience that we would consider tolerable stresses. These are things that are pretty bad, like the death of a grandparent or a car accident. They're things that are going to stimulate their stress response, but they happen in the context of buffering relationships by caring adults who help kids understand what's going on and support them through these threatening events. Unfortunately, for many of our kids, they're experiencing toxic stress. These are those strong, frequent, or prolonged adversities that are not buffered by adults. And that lack of buffering is the critical piece here. They're happening often at the hands of or because of a caregiver not being available to a child. And those are the things that are going to do more permanent changing of the brain in negative ways. So let's look at what they're doing. The reason we understand what's happening actually has to do with what we understand about how we as humans respond to threat. You know, when I was in training, in addition to having that great embryology professor, I learned actually only about the freeze response and the fight or flight response. Now, freeze response in response to threat is that the tiger's coming at you and you just stay still. And that is actually not that effective for humans. We're too big. It might work for a mouse or a possum, but if we just stay still, the tiger's going to see us and they're going to probably eat us. The other option that I knew about was fight or flight. The tiger's coming at you and you can either try to run away or you can try to fight the tiger. In fact, for humans, we're actually not that good at these either, right? We don't have claws, we can't hide underwater. So if a tiger is coming at us, especially if we are a child, if we are with children, we are pregnant, we're not going to be very good at fight or flight at all. And so if freeze and fight or flight were the only options available to us as humans, we actually wouldn't have survived. So in fact, more research recently has identified the fact that the stress response humans use preferentially and most effectively is the affiliate response. What that means is that under threat, the very first thing that we do is we actually look left and right and we say, hey, are there humans here who can help me? And if there are humans here who can help me deal with this threat, I actually become more pro-social. I am better able to gather people to me and we deal with the threat together. And as that happens, my stress level drops considerably. If I look left and right and the humans that are supposed to help me can't help me, won't help me, or they want to hurt me too, now I've got two problems. I actually have to fight those humans and I have to fight the original threat. And so I actually become more antisocial and I get shoved over to fight or flight. That's all I have left to use. I would suggest as an aside that as a culture, as we came out of being locked down, one of the reasons why we were as a nation at each other's throats was partially because affiliate response had been lost to us. We had been locked away from each other and couldn't connect. And so we were left with just fight or flight. And so we as a nation responded in ways that were very aggressive. But what we see for our kids is that if they can't use affiliate response, all they can use is fight or flight. And what that is a turning up and turning on of what's called the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. Stress activates this axis and we have this release of epinephrine and cortisol. And the idea is that we get this burst of energy so that we can run from this tiger or fight this tiger. But this system is really only designed to last for 20 minutes. You're supposed to use affiliate, and this one is really supposed to be for short duration. So what happens is that cortisol comes out, it hits cortisol receptors on your brain, and that starts to shut the system down almost as soon as it's turned on. You know this because suppose you were driving somewhere and someone comes out and almost cuts you off. You have this surge of adrenaline and cortisol, and then if you get out of the situation, you swerve and you drive on, you feel your body being so drained in those next minutes as you're continuing on in your drive. And that's your body shutting down the stress response. But for our kids, that tiger lives in their home or their neighborhood or their life, and something different is happening. They can't use affiliate. So now, bang, 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 it is pounding on their brain saying, make more cortisol, just keep making more. That's going to hit the body systems, which are supposed to help them fight the tiger. It's going to hit their immune system, turning up their inflammatory response and turning down their ability to fight infection. And also, as an aside, when we wonder why communities who are already stressed are having the hardest time with COVID, we understand it's because their immunity and their ability to fight infection is lower, and their inflammatory response, or the body fighting itself, has been turned on. We also see changes at the gene level. But let me back up and show you the three major ways that kids get impacted. It is with brain connectivity, immune function, and epigenetics. Let's think about if this cortisol is pouring down on the brain, a brain that is rapidly developing. It's going to hit some places preferentially, and one of the places it's going to hit is the amygdala. Now, the amygdala is the part of your brain that is responsible for being your emotional memory system. It allows you to remember something about an event so that as soon as that little something comes to your attention, you know, be alerted. It's why if you smell that perfume that your grandma used to wear, you suddenly remember grandma. It's also why kids who have been experiencing a lot of trauma have an amygdala that gets bigger and bigger and bigger, because they have to remember something about these dangerous situations so they can react the next time. The hippocampus is the part of your brain that you use to access information and sort of say, do I know something about this? Have I learned something about this in the past that I can apply to today? You can think about it like your brain's file cabinet or search engine. And it has a big role in memory and learning, but it's actually not very useful to you under threat. I don't want to look at that tiger coming at me and think, what do I know about tigers? Have I read something about tigers? No, that would be dangerous. That would slow me down. And so the hippocampus in our kids atrophies or starts to go away. Then there's the prefrontal cortex. This is the part of your brain that's responsible for executive function, impulse control, working memory, cognitive flexibility. It allows me to do really well in school so that I can remember what we learned yesterday and apply it to today and sit in my seat. But it's also not very useful to me at all under threat, right? I don't want to control my impulses. I don't want to learn from what happens. I don't want to memorize this. And so the prefrontal cortex also comes offline. And so we have these big alarms, we have an inability to access information, and we don't have any executive function. If you think about Thomas, the young man in the audio that I played before, if you keep listening to this story, you hear some of the other concerns that if he had been brought to see me, I would have been paying attention to. One is that they say he's not sleeping. That was the point in the audio. You also find out that he's been overeating, that he has asthma that's gotten worse, that he often gets headaches, that he's a short attention span and academic difficulty, which is why he was there talking with the adjustment counselor and the reporter. But let's think about the sleeping. Well, one of the parts of the brain that gets affected in addition to those places that I pointed out already is what's called the reticular activating system. Under threat, if a tiger is kind of pacing outside my cave, it's not a good time for me to go to sleep, right? I should stay awake, stay alert. And so for our kids, they often have lots of difficulty falling asleep and staying asleep. If I have one concern, that's the most common one that I hear in the foster care program that I take to, that I run, it's this, that foster parents are so frustrated because kids won't sleep. But in fact, that's their brain doing exactly what it was supposed to do to keep them safe. This issue with a short attention span and academic difficulty is probably one that you've heard from people talking about what we need to do for schools. And many times the kids come to us with these concerns. Little kids come in and we know that just if they've been exposed to trauma, if you just think about the impact on that prefrontal cortex, we're gonna start to see some of these symptoms, right? So for that infant or toddler or preschooler, without working memory, they can't pick up their developmental milestones. Without that inhibitory control, they're gonna have lots of tantrums, they don't have nice hands, they can't play nice in the sandbox, and attachment can get impacted. And without cognitive flexibility, they can't remember how they told you to tie your shoes yesterday and do it today. So they get frustrated. So these 3 and 4-year-olds are brought to my office and people say, hey, you know, I think this little guy has ADHD, because that's what it looks like if you're not considering trauma. By the time that child gets to school age, they don't have working memory, so they can't keep up with school skill acquisition. They also can't remember what just happened, but they're often in situations where people say, tell me what happened, darn it, tell me, but they can't remember. So they learn to sort of come up with something really quick because that's very protective, but that's viewed by other people as lying. And because they don't have inhibitory control, so they often are getting in trouble for fighting or disrupting, now we're starting to get a picture of this kid as sort of a bad kid. They have organizational difficulties, and because they don't have cognitive flexibility, they have these learning problems that looks a lot like ADHD, but usually by this age, we're already starting to consider diagnoses like conduct disorder or oppositional defiant disorder. By the time those kids are adolescents like Thomas, they can't keep up with material, they can't keep things organized, and that confabulation issue is now an integrity issue. They're not just a kid who's had bad things happen, they're a bad kid. And these impulsive actions land them in trouble with the law and in my emergency room. And so that's sort of reinforced. And they can't even keep a job at McDonald's because they can't do two things at once, like make change and take an order. They can't drive very well because they can't play with the radio and pay attention to the road. And so we begin to see that this trauma is now profoundly being misidentified by those of us, particularly in the medical community, because we're not thinking about what has happened to this child. In fact, we may see impacts that kind of go across the age span and across generations. And this is because we are impacting people even at the gene level. You know, many of you may hear that we pour resources into some families and they sort of seems like for generations they've been struggling. And that's because of what we know about how trauma is impacting not just the individual, but it's impacting and changing which genes gets transcribed. So this became known to us by a researcher named Michael Meany, who was studying rats. And what he knew is that mommy rats normally lick their baby rats constantly. Lick, 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 lick. And if mommy licks her baby rat, that baby rat grows up and becomes a healthy, well-adjusted, normal rat. If mommy is put into a threatening situation, like we put a predator in her cage, or we shock her, or we take away her food, she stops licking the baby. And if that baby does not get licked, that baby grows up to be an anxious, nervous rat, even if that baby is not under any threat at all. But if I take that baby rat and I take it away from the anxious mommy and I give it to a foster mommy rat, and that foster mommy rat licks that baby can grow up and be perfectly well-adjusted and lick her own babies. So what was going on? And that's what Michael Meany realized. What we have is an area in front of every gene called a promoter region. And the promoter region is not the gene itself, but it's an area that says, should this gene be turned on or turned off? And there are experiences that we have in childhood that determine whether a gene gets turned on or turned off. As it turns out, a mommy licking her baby rat takes away some sugars from in front of the gene for the glucocorticoid receptor. Remember, a few slides ago, I told you that as soon as you make cortisol, it comes out and it goes to glucocorticoid receptors on the brain. It locks onto those to help shut the system down. Those glucocorticoid receptors have to get made through these genes. But if mommy does not lick her baby, that those methyl groups or sugars stay blocking that gene from being made into those glucocorticoid receptors. Those babies never get glucocorticoid receptors in their brain. And so you can pump out adrenaline and cortisol all day long, and your body never recognizes that you're pumping it out. So you just stay in this high alert state all your life. Now that is very protective from an evolutionary standpoint. A baby should know that they are being born into a dangerous situation. But for those of us who live in this society where we can start to put resources in, we have to find ways that we can alter and reestablish these genes, turning those promoter regions off or on, because it's not just this gene that's impacted. There are many, many genes that are impacted. There are research studies looking at Holocaust survivors' great-grandchildren, and genes that were either turned off or turned on based on their experiences are still impacting great-grandchildren. Fortunately, some of our therapies and medications can impact these epigenetic regions, but this is an area of profound and important research and one that is rapidly evolving. We know it's not just rats, we know it's humans too. A more recent study looked at children who were born to mothers with postpartum depression. We know that children who are born to moms with postpartum depression are much more likely to be anxious as children. What they did is a research study where they couldn't get the IRB to approve licking, but they had volunteers stroke infants whose moms had postpartum depression. And what they found is that if those babies got that stroking, they could grow up and not develop anxiety. But if they did not get that stroking, they grew up and were more likely to be anxious. And what they found is that the difference was that stroking altered this epigenetic region, allowing them to either turn on or not turn on their glucocorticoid receptor gene. So it is profoundly important for us in humans as well as for the rats. Okay, what about immune function? I mentioned some about this, and certainly we would have heard that Thomas has asthma and he often gets headaches. That's important to me in the medical setting to know that this inflammatory response is turned up and infection fighting is turned down. Like my kids that come into foster care are much more likely to get sick, and they are much more likely to have an inflammatory response persisting even when it's not needed. So they're more likely to have things that are diseases of the overdoing of an immune response. They're more likely to have asthma. They're more likely to have metabolic syndrome. They're more likely to have autoimmune disease. The other thing that they are more likely to have is their somatic perception impaired. They just don't feel well. It's called the sick syndrome. And what this is that under threat, our bodies are trying to get us to stay in the cave, right? The safest place for us to stay if a tiger is outside our cave is in the cave. But we as humans are not good at staying put. So we won't stay in the cave unless the governor gives a stay-at-home order or we don't feel well. And so you know this, on your most stressful days, you don't usually wake up and say, hey, it's a great day, I feel lovely today. You wake up in the morning and you're like, oh, I got a headache, I got a stomachache, oh, I got to deal with that thing. That is your body saying to you, stay in the cave. Please stay in the cave. For our kids, they often feel yucky. And when I talk to school nurses, they say, oh, these are our kids. They sit in our nurse's office all the time. They certainly are brought to my office too. Because under threat, you just don't feel well because your body's trying to keep you safe. Unfortunately, if we let this sick syndrome continue on, it actually is related to immune processes hitting a particular part of the brain. Over time, that sick syndrome can evolve into a form of depression. And there's some research studies looking at whether that form of depression would be better served by treatment with anti-inflammatory drugs instead of antidepressant drugs. That's still in the research stages, and I am not telling you that we can change how we treat kids' depression, but it has profound impact on how we think about these kids and what's going on for them. Okay, so some of you are like, okay, you know what, Forky? I know a lot of kids. I know that sometimes kids experience one bad thing and they're kind of a mess. And then I know other people who've experienced a ton of bad things and they did just fine. So this childhood experience thing, I don't buy it. And you know what? You actually have a really good reason to be skeptical, because childhood experience is not destiny. There is this variable response to adversity. Kids do not all respond the same way. And so for some time, we held a theory called the diathesis stress model. This was the idea that due to some genetic vulnerability, some people would do better and some people would do less, more poorly with adversity. that doesn't make sense, because if there's no genetic advantage, why would any of these vulnerability alleles be conserved, right? Why would that stay in the gene pool? That doesn't make any sense. In fact, there is a better explanation, and it's called the orchids and dandelions, or biological differential sensitivity to context. This is not going to be a shocker to you. You know that there are many kids, kind of no matter what happens, they're a little less swayed by experiences. They do okay, kind of bad or good, they muddle through. We call these kids the dandelions. There are other kids who are predisposed to being much more sensitive or reactive to the environment. Often these are kids who are particularly skilled or are gifted or talented, and yet they really have to be protected and nurtured or they're going to not do very well. And in fact, the advantage to each depends on context. So if you are a kid in Afghanistan right now, boy, oh boy, you better be a dandelion. And if you live in one of our Massachusetts communities where you have a great library and great schools and a great family, you could be an orchid or a dandelion and you're going to do great. And so what this construct, while we understand it better in terms of which alleles are in fact happening, it's not new to you. You've actually heard this. You've talked about the sensitive child or the artistic child. In fact, Disney uses it all the time. And the movie Frozen is all about one orchid and one dandelion. For those of you that have not seen Frozen, and if you're working on children's issues, shame on you, you should watch Frozen. But if you haven't seen Frozen, there are two princesses, Elsa and Anna. Elsa has this great gift. She's quite talented. She can make snow things with her hands. And she keeps playing with her sister and making these snow playgrounds for her sister. When one day she's creating the snow playground and her sister goes to jump off something and the power comes out of her hand to try to create a slide, but instead she zaps her sister in the head, knocking her sister out cold. Elsa is devastated, so upset. So the family says, okay, we got to deal with this. And they take her to the doctor, to the trolls that are the people who know something about what's going on. And they say, look, you know, she's very gifted, but you're going to have to work with her so that she can manage this gift. Well, then what happens is that Disney does what Disney always does. And they create this horrible stressor where they kill the parents. That's what Disney does in every film. They kill the parents. But there's two kids and they react differently because one's an orchid and one's a dandelion. Let me show you. This is a scene where you see all that happen.
Getting upset only makes it worse.
Calm They're working down. With
no,
her
don't touch me.
As she tries to control her gift.
I don't want to hurt you.
And there's her sister Anna, the dandelion.
See you in 2 weeks.
Parents are headed off to Rapunzel's wedding.
Do you have to go?
You'll be fine.
No, she's not going to be fine. It's not going to go very well. Parents board the ship. And if you're watching this with your small child or grandchild or your nephew, you have to go after the plane and get this pregnant. And there's the artistic rendering of the parents' demise. What you see immediately is that only one child shows up for the funeral. And now, you see Anna trying to reach out and to support her sister, to provide that affiliate support.
Elsa, please, I know you're in there. People are asking where you've been. They say have courage, and I'm trying to. I'm right out here for you. Just let me in. We only have each other. It's just you and me. What are we gonna do?
She's gonna come up with a great technique.
Build a snowman.
Building a snowman would help. It would help quite a bit. But you see that Elsa, same stressor, is completely differently affected. And so what did Disney and Pixar know? They knew that Elsa had a dopamine D4 receptor. Those kids have externalizing behaviors when there's maternal insensitivity or loss, but they respond very positively to positive parenting technique. Elsa is going to go on and eventually become a juvenile delinquent. She will lash out when presented with another stressor, freezing the whole town and becoming the most wanted criminal in the whole land. It is possible that she also had high cortisol reactivity, because these kids are less prosocial when they live in adverse context, more prosocial when living in more nurturing context. And of course, I'm joking, but what these movies show us is that the very kids who struggle the most under adversity could be the luminaries of the next generation. And it is incumbent on us, those who are working with these kids, to recognize what we're seeing. I will say to you that these brain and physiologic changes allow the adversity to embed. They're adaptive in the short term. They help kids cope, but they are maladaptive over the life course. In fact, when Frozen came out, my youngest child was of the perfect demographic for Frozen. And I listened to the song a gazillion times in my car. And eventually I had to tell them, turn it off, because it is about the biological embedding of trauma. Listen to these words. It is about someone who has experienced a great trauma. And she has shut herself down. A kingdom of isolation. And it looks like I'm the queen. Because she is completely shut herself up and dissociated in order to cope with this toxic swirling storm inside. Couldn't keep it in. Heaven knows I tried. She's going to explain to you the DSM diagnosis of dissociative disorder. Let them in, don't let them see. Be the good girl you always have to be. Conceal, don't feel. Don't let them know. Now she has to externalize and deal with the threat in a very violent manner. Okay, I'm sorry, people. That whole song, it's incredibly distressing to me. It is about trauma. Okay, but I got your ass. Okay, how do we identify and respond? How do we move forward? One of the things that is so critical is that we begin to recognize these kids. And when I talk to people in schools and people in daycares and other medical professionals, we have to begin to recognize what we're seeing. Some of these kids present as tigers, externalizing behaviors, particularly when they've been exposed to violence and physical abuse, but we can misidentify those kids as ADHD. Other kids shut themselves into themselves. If you can't fight, you actually have to hide within yourself to deal with the threat. And so these kids, especially if there's chronic abuse or they're young or developmentally delayed, they can be misidentified as being depressed or having dissociative disorder. Some kids kind of vacillate, and we see this in kids who have parents who are substance misusing or parents who are mentally ill, because they have to keep reading the room. And these kids get misidentified as manipulators or fake. They don't have good connections. And finally, we have kids just like Elsa, who rigidly follow the rules. They try to please, they try to do exactly what they're supposed to do. But when they don't have a consistent or available caregiver because of loss, you can see these explosive anger concerns, just like for Elsa, where she exploded and she froze the whole town. And so we have to begin to recognize this in our kids. We also need to recognize where it overlaps with some of those diagnoses that have traditionally been made and called in the schools and in the daycares, because there is overlap with ADHD, and there is overlap with anxiety, and there is overlap with mood disorder. And we have to recognize what we're seeing. But we also have to recognize that we know what to do, because if we understand what positive, tolerable, and toxic stress do, we also understand why they happen. They happen because of the loss of that affiliate response. And so what makes a stressor tolerable versus toxic isn't just the stressor. It has to do with whether it's buffered by supportive relationships, protective relationships. And so we can do and think about what to do by building those protective relationships. The context of trauma and resilience is always in relationship or attachment. If you can or cannot use the affiliate response, do I have those people to help me deal with threat? And so if I've talked to you this whole time about trauma, you would be right to say, you know, Forky, I don't want to just deal with trauma. I want to build resilience in kids. Yes, you do. Because resilience isn't something you're born with, you either have or don't have. Resilience is grown in our kids through these relationships. Resilience was defined by Ann Mastin, who was a great resilience researcher, as this dynamic process of positive adaptation to or in spite of significant adversities. It gets applied to a kid, a family, a system, a community, or ecosystem. But for kids, it's rooted in that give and take of safe, stable, and nurturing relationships, those attachments that kids have, and in the growth through normal activities, play, exploration, exposure, all those things that I talked about early on that are helping that brain to grow and develop. So what can we do to make this happen? Ann Mastin called this ordinary magic. Isn't that a great term? Boy, it's so ordinary. It's happening all the time without us even noticing it. And yet, boy, when it doesn't happen, we know that there's some magic there, and we got to figure out how to make that magic happen. But we know how to do it. There are four key things that we can do. Another Disney show, Toy Story 4, has a character named Forky, which just happens to be my name too. But there are four key things that we can do. We need to promote safety and security, safety that is both physical safety and psychological safety for kids. We need to make sure that the adults in their lives are available in predictable and compassionate ways. We need to make sure that we look at the world through that child's perspective, looking at the world with their mind in mind, not just how we view the world, but how they view the world. And we need to help be emotional containers for these kids who've experienced so much that has been so upsetting. You know, safety is critical because unless you can shut down the stress response, make people feel safe, kids have got to react to it. There is a reason why the word anger is embedded in the word danger. Because for many kids, the only way to deal with how they feel unsafe is to get bigger and louder than it. So often in our schools, people say, God, this kid is so angry all the time. Actually, that kid is experiencing a feeling of danger all the time. And anger is the only way he knows how to respond to it, because that's what's going to keep him safe. We need to have adults in these kids' lives that are predictably and compassionately available to them. Available to them when they need them under threat, but available to show them how the best that they can be. Because, and this is where the M comes in, we need to look at the world with the child's mind in mind. Let me go into this just a little bit more. I'm sorry. I know I've done more physiology than you probably can stand, but we've talked about the brain structures that are critical so that you can understand the outside world, the amygdala, the hippocampus, the prefrontal cortex. But there are also brain structures that help you understand yourself, right? You know, we have this misidea in America that you figure yourself out, that you know, that Jack Kerouac, you go on the road and you just figure yourself out. We don't figure ourselves out. We get figured out by people who reflect us to us. And that creates this mental map of yourself and the world. That happens through a series of structures in the brain that is called the default mode network. This is a series of structures that start in the front of your brain and kind of track all the way to the back of your brain. But these are engaged when you're not in a directed activity. It's sometimes thought of as the resting hum. It's the time where you sort of just zone out. You know that you have used your default mode network when you had an event happen at work and you drove home and you suddenly got home and you don't remember the drive because you were thinking about the interaction you had with people and how you were perceived. You were in your default mode network working out who are you and what was going on for you. You know, what that part of the brain does is it supports understanding self, because what happens is that adults for kids shine a light on kids and help them understand themselves. When a child baby cries and the caregiver picks up the baby, the caregiver says, oh, you're hungry, and I'm going to help you with that. And the child learns, oh, this feeling, that one's hunger, and people help me with that. And when the toddler is frustrated trying to climb up the stairs and the caregiver says, hey, buddy, you know, you're frustrated. Let's see if we can help you with those stairs. The child learns, this feeling, that one's frustrated, and people help me with that. If kids are reflected incorrectly, that is not what they learn. You know, if the caregiver hears the baby crying and screams at the baby, oh, would you just shut up? You're so damn greedy. That baby learns this feeling, that one's being greedy, and no one helps you. And if the child's trying to climb up the stairs and the caregiver says, what are you, stupid? You can't figure it out? The child learns this feeling is being stupid, and there's nothing that you can do about that. As that child reflects on themselves, they begin to understand themselves in a very different way. And that understanding of self either makes you understand that you are worthy of being cared for and that the world is manageable, or that you are not worthy of being cared for and the world is unmanageable. And so for many of our kids who don't have this accurate reflection, people not looking at the world with their mind in mind, not allowing their default mode network to develop and understand them accurately, those kids now are in danger both from the outside, from the threats that are happening to them, and from the inside, the part of them that doesn't understand themselves. And so it becomes especially important then that we have adults who can be emotional containers to hold what's going on for kids so that when they show up in the next situation and it reminds them of something that they can't handle or that was scary to them, that adult tolerates those strong emotions, recognizing that this child's going to act out with this safe adult, but the emotion's not going to be about them, and the caregiver needs to respond calmly and help name those feelings. We have to switch what we are doing from what's wrong with you, kid, to what happened to you. And what can we do to make it so that you can begin to understand yourself and the world in a healthy new way? Luckily, in Massachusetts, we have the best of resources for kids and families. We may not have enough, but we do have the best. There are evidence-based trauma therapies for young kids, which are attunement therapies, which help adults come to understand how to read this child. Child-parent psychotherapy, parent-child interaction therapy. There are therapies to help kids manage and understand the trauma that happened to them. Trauma-focused cognitive behavioral therapy is the best studied, and we have great resources for that here in Massachusetts. And we are the state in which attachment regulation and competency was developed for complex trauma, for kids who've had multiple traumas over many years of their life and really need to come to understand themselves from the inside and from the outside. What we need to do is to recognize these kids and what our role is in protecting them and understanding what's going on for them. You know, if you continue to listen to that audio, you'll hear Thomas say, "If it happens again, I don't think I could stop." Meaning I would fight that kid to a much more severe level. And we certainly in Massachusetts see this. We have tertiary care facilities, those inpatient or residential places for kids where we misidentify them as being mentally ill, when in fact it's been trauma all along. And if we don't recognize and address it, then we have a quaternary care system that matches some in the rest of the country, where we see that people who are incarcerated have trauma experiences up in the 90%. It is much more likely for someone to be incarcerated to have an ACE score of 4 or more. And that is not a coincidence. But the good news is that Frozen 2 just came out. We have plenty more to say, and we can keep talking about this in the rest of this series.